I wanted to say good morning before we went to the
It's all starting.
All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, what an awesome sight. Welcome this morning to our morning worship service outdoor edition here at Journey Baptist Church. I invite you to stand. Let's open up in singing Days of Elijah. The words up here, hopefully you can see it. See, these are the days.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword, till we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Now the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
These are the days.
These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. Your fields are as wide in your world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation.
So lift your voice,
so lift your voice, it's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we praise you and thank you, Lord, for this morning. We thank you, Lord, for blessing us with just another opportunity to be in your house this morning. And so we just pray for your spirit, Lord, just to continue to minister through these songs, Lord, continue to minister through our pastor, Lord. We thank you for the many that were able to be here live, Lord, and those that might be tuning in. We just pray again that your spirit would just be able to connect with each and every one of us. And so we just offer this service to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name.
Sing out your name.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. A shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
See Jesus?
Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder. Nothing has the power to save. Because nothing has the power to save but your name. Your name.
Sing above all.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
Sing it out, crucified.
Crucified, laid behind the stone. You lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and bought me above all.
See, crucified. Amen. You may be seated.
Found a new use for mass. A little human out this morning. Just wanted to let you know that we are having tech issues this morning, so it's a good thing you came in person. Otherwise, you'd be frustrated at home right now. Facebook's working, but YouTube is off the air again, and so we're trying to figure out what's going on with that. But we don't want that to be the thing that we think about this morning. This morning, we're focusing our attention on the persecuted church. I don't know how many of you have spent any time considering what's happening in our world today, and there's a lot going on. Lots of things happening to people. But let me just give you a verse to start us off with. Hebrews 13:3. If you just, you want to write that down, you want to turn to it, be my guest. I can't take a lot of time with it because I want to make sure that we keep moving. I have a lot to cover and I want to make sure you understand it. And so Hebrews 13:3 says, remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. Powerful statement. Remember them as if you're in the actual cell with them. Remember them as if you're actually taking the beatings with them for their faith. And so that's a big difference than just knowing about it and being, okay, yeah, somebody's having that problem. I don't have that problem. It's not my issue. It's actually connecting the body of Christ together in a beautiful way where we recognize what's happening in our world. This past Wednesday, things got off to a crazy start for my family. I was out walking, and you know, I walk every morning. I want you to know how committed I am to walking every morning. That makes me feel good that you know I'm committed to it. Anyway, it was my prayer time and a little exercise, and then a text message comes through. You know, you're out there, you're totally with the Lord. You know, nobody's ever distracted while they're walking and praying. This distraction comes in. It's the tree trimmer. The tree trimmer trimmer is coming to my house, going to take the trees, take all the extra stuff off the trees. And he was supposed to come on Saturday, but now he's going to come in 30 minutes. And so, I just got to walk a little faster, get back to the house, and no problem. I'll just move the cars and get ready for him. Wasn't planning on it. Wednesday is trash day, so all the cars are up in the driveway under the trees. And that just kind of started a landslide, if you would. I went out to move my oldest son's car. Dead battery. Okay, that's just how it starts. Under his car is absolutely under the tree. Okay, my youngest son was having a rough morning. A little tension began to rise, and when Julie returned from dropping Jared off from school, she said, "I'm going to put on the armor of God because the enemy is attacking." And so, yeah, the armor of God is for that, and I'm sure she used this for the ladies' Bible study that evening. I just kind of threw in there, kind of off the cuff. Ready for this? Probably because of what I was already thinking about talking about. She said she's going to put on the armor of God. And I said, persecution is rising, so we better arm ourselves. And once it left my lips, I had to add, we have such a warped view of persecution. If a dead battery, a rough morning, and a little family tension is all we've got, right? I mean, that's a warped view of persecution. If that, we're having a bad day and we call that persecution. So I wanted to, before we even really got started, just kind of set that off the table. I don't want us thinking about your bad day as the equivalent of persecution. I want you to recognize that there's way more than that. And so let me put it this way. If you would, while I'm speaking, turn to John chapter number 15. John 15. And while you're turning there, to think we have the audacity to call our difficulties with blessing maintenance. Now think about that. What we're talking about right there, when we're talking about a car not starting, a car is a blessing, right? We're talking about tree trimming, and being able to afford a tree trimmer instead of doing it myself, or even have a house that has trees. Any of that stuff, those are all blessings. And so I want you to understand this. We can't call blessings maintenance persecution. It can't be that. It's not that. It's not even really tough times. We need to understand that as well. Those aren't even tough times. Now, that might be the toughest time you experienced so far, but that's not tough times. That's not even persecution. To think we consider not getting an invite or someone saying no to our invitation to church or a mean article in the media towards Christians is persecution. These are just reminders. Please understand that. You might be saying, oh yeah, a mean article or a bad word against Christians in the media, that's persecution. Well, sort of. But not the kind I'm talking about this morning. That might be the onset, or that might be the early bell ringing that persecution is coming, but it's not actually persecution in the physical sense. I mean, these are just reminders that sinful man is hostile towards God, right? And godly values. They don't like godly values. But it's not technically persecution because it's not really inflicting any infringement or any harm on us. But most people that attend church today have no idea what real persecution is or if it even exists. And because of that, most really have no idea what our responsibility is towards those who suffer for just simply having a faith in Jesus. I'm not talking about the person that's obnoxious with their faith and causes people to respond with obnoxious behavior. I'm talking about a person living the Christian life as directed in the Scripture and suffering for it. Those are the differences. And I hope by the end of this message, you'll recognize why living a genuinely Christian or Christ-like lifestyle is so important. It gets us ready. We need to live ready. And so follow along as I read in John chapter number 15. I'm going to read a few verses, so just try to follow along as I do. It says in verse number 18, chapter number 15, it says, "If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they have not him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not sinned, but not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin. He that hateth me hateth my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not sinned. But now have they both seen and hated both me and my Father. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me, and ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. Now in chapter 16, I want you to scan all the way to the end, verse number 33. It says, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity we have this morning to recognize what real persecution is and how you have said in your word, how it will come, when, what it will look like, what we can do to be prepared for, what our response should be. Oh, Lord, I pray that you would let this fall heavy on our hearts this morning to consider those around the world that are suffering. We may not even be aware of the things that are happening, but maybe by the end of today, we will be. Lord, I pray that your spirit would be free to flow amongst us this morning. I pray for those watching on our live stream that they would have the same experience that we're having in person, that your presence would be felt, and that they'd be moved by you to walk closer to you. Lord, we thank you for all this now, and we ask you to help us to please you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let me just start with an article I read this past week. It was entitled, Renounce Your Christian Faith or Run for Your Life. That's the grim dilemma Christians are facing as violent persecution continues to rise in India. Indian families have been targeted, beaten, and thrown out of their homes simply because of their Christian faith. Christians are being ordered to renounce their faith in Jesus or suffer grave consequences such as hanging, stoning, and torture. Violent radical Hindus feel empowered to commit heinous, illegal atrocities against Christians without any fear because the police won't register their cases. Indian police often side with the violent Hindu persecutors rather than the Christian minority who are constantly facing threats, evictions, and physical violence. Indian Christians feel defenseless and afraid to report their persecution for fear of reprisal. Now they have nowhere to turn. And this is happening more than you think. It shouldn't even really be a surprise to us. Jesus, just after he told his followers how much he loved them and how much they should love one another, he reveals that they are what they would be personally facing and why. In fact, number one, if you're following along this morning and taking some notes, persecution is the lost world's response to Jesus. That's the lost world's natural response to Jesus, is persecution. In fact, in our passage today, we saw that he says, if you love me, then they're going to hate you. It's just a natural process. For reasons the lost world really doesn't know or understand, the enemy of all who live, Satan himself, presses his own to respond violently to God's people. I don't know if you've noticed that, but people have kind of a natural angst against morality, Christian values. The whole idea of Christianity seems to kind of anger people today. People of faith are routinely mocked here, even here in the U.S. It's kind of a routine thing. The rear end of every joke is the Christian person, or the person who's trying to live by some sort of standard in their life is the one that's mocked. And it isn't a secret. In fact, if you're taking notes, Jesus anticipated persecution. Verses 18 through 20 in our passage tell us that he anticipated it. In fact, just the very first verse there, it says, if the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. And if you were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. It's just a natural thing. He's not surprised by it. Jesus actually told us we shouldn't be surprised by it either. Every Easter Sunday, do you realize that we celebrate the pinnacle of persecution against Christ? We celebrate that because his death, burial, right? Well, that was caused by persecution. But the power of God is the Resurrection Sunday that we celebrate. And so persecution is what brought about his death, right? And so it's expected. He expected it and he warned us of it. But we also see here that Jesus is the reason for persecution. If you go into verse number 21 in our passage, it says, but all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake. Period. He said, this is what's going to happen. And it's really not about you. It's about me. They don't like me. We shouldn't take it too personally because it's really not about us. It's really about him. It's a key piece of evidence of the great spiritual battle that's taking place, right? It's a big piece of it. Think about it this way. Jesus is our king and the world is in rebellion to our king, right? So if we live for our king, we have to deal with the rebels. Well, think about it the other way. In the world's eyes, they are fighting for their king, right? And we are the ones in rebellion to them. And so it's a very natural angst between the two groups. Our resistance to unbiblical ways angers them, because unbiblical ways are the framework of what they're doing. Persecution, or I should say this way, as with any war, there are casualties, right? In any war, there are casualties. There's no way to avoid it. Persecution, Jesus says, is the evidence that they do not know God. It's also evidence that believers are living by God's word. If you're suffering actual persecution, now remember this, I'm not talking about you being mean to people in your Christian faith or being so forward that you're like trying to jam it down their throats. Remember, we're supposed to be loving and considerate of others. And if you're really living the genuine Christian life, we should be actually experiencing a little bit of persecution. It's natural for us to have that. Romans 1, 19 and 20 tells us this reality. People are doing wrong and do not like to hear that it's wrong. Have you noticed that? That people want their wrongs praised. In fact, they want their wrongs to be relabeled as right. And that's what we're facing today in the United States. And if it continues down this path, anyone who says it's wrong will be on the other side of the law, basically. That's what's going to happen. We're almost there now, where it's almost illegal for me to say that certain things are right or wrong in opposition to things that others might want to be right or wrong. In fact, let me read the Bible to you. Romans 1, 19 and 20 says, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. It removes excuses that soothe their conscience. The Word of God does. When we live by the Word of God, we stand as a testimony against their excuses. And those excuses are what they're using to soothe what they're doing, so they don't sense that wrongness. They feel victimized by us. Did you know that? That they feel like if we say what they're doing is wrong according to the Word of God, they feel like that's victimizing them. And so, but listen to this. We don't have to worry about it, because Jesus prepares us for persecution. If you look at verses 26 and 27 in our text, he prepares us for persecution. Notice it here. He says, but when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. And so we see this powerful passage. He prepares us with the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit it guides us with truth. The Holy Spirit guides us in wisdom and discernment. That Holy Spirit is that basically that entry-level preparation for persecution. Jesus also gave us something the world envies. If you go to 16:33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. Isn't that what the whole world is trying to find? They're trying to find peace, and they're trying to find peace in anything they want to do instead of what God says will bring peace. And so we're equipped with the power of peace. That comes from confidence in Jesus and serves to calm our fears. Amen? Don't you love the fact that when we walk with God, we walk with a sense of peace no matter what's happening around us? And then we also are encouraged by the power of the gospel. See, we can live with rejoicing under persecution because Jesus has already won the victory for us. Amen? Think about that phrase, I have overcome the world. Amen? Amen. He's already overcome. It's not something right. I will one day overcome. I've already won. Right. Now I'm asking you to live as if that's true, that we've already won the victory. And so because Jesus has already won, listen to this carefully, we have a different mission. Now just let this sink in. Instead of defeating our enemies, we are called to love them and win them over to Jesus. Amen? That's the difference. Their mission is to defeat. Our mission is not to defeat them with slaughter, but with the blood of Jesus. It's a very different mission. It's a very different warfare. We should expect persecution. Jesus suffered persecution and actually is what they're really fighting against, and he prepares us for it. Amen? Are you good? So far, so good? We're ready? Okay, well, that's number two. Let's go on to another one. Persecution isn't just the lost world's response to God. Number two, persecution serves a significant purpose. Persecution actually serves a purpose. In fact, take your Bible, go to 1 Peter chapter number 3, if you would. We're going to read here for a minute. 1 Peter chapter number 3. And verses 13 through 17, and then I'm just going to kind of cruise down the page for you on a few things. Chapter number 3, starting with verse number 13. It says in this, it says, "And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? But and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, that they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better if the will of God be so that ye suffer for doing well than for evil, or for doing evil, excuse me, or evil doing." Wow, it's just a powerful statement there. Little does our enemy know, when persecution rises, it actually fuels their own defeat instead of ours. Amen? So when they persecute us, they're actually doing something that I'm going to share with you right now that you wouldn't actually expect to come. And so I guess I'm going to answer the how question. Well, first of all, by revealing that persecution is a byproduct of a fallen world. Think about this. That's just what happens in a fallen world. People have rejected God for centuries, actually for thousands and thousands of years. Think about this. Peter tells believers how they can prepare for it. First thing is, understand God does not cause directly persecution. Just so you know, he doesn't cause directly. It's not like he's got a brew of persecution. He keeps pouring it out on us. Okay? That's not exactly how it worked, because that would make God an accomplice to this evil. When all is as it should be and everyone is living in obedience to God, we should have no fear of doing right. All right? Does that make sense to you? If everything is as God would want it to be exactly, how he created it to be originally, there would be no fear in doing right. But now that we're on the other side of that equation, where we didn't do it the way we should have, and we're now suffering under this bondage to sin, we have all this going on in our world, and there's a battle between good and evil. And so in an imperfect world filled with people who reject God's authority, the gospel is often suppressed, and there's an attempt to silence it by worldly powers. That's what happens in a world where sin is in charge. People simply do not want to hear the truth because it offends them, right? That's what we're dealing with today. A lot of people are offended by the truth. They don't want to hear it. Secondly, listen to this. God does allow it. See, understand this. He might not be so complicit in it, but he is definitely allowing it because he is totally sovereign. He has something to say about it. And the question then arises, if God is allowing persecution to take place, why? Right? Isn't that the question that would come to your mind? Why is God allowing persecution? One reason is that God, while not causing persecution, uses it for his purposes and to glorify himself in the church. Isn't that powerful? He can take it and turn it that direction. He can change the whole thing. Listen, how might he be doing that? Well, first of all, persecution is a path to blessings. If you look at verse number 14 with me, really quickly, it says, "But and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled." There's a blessing in here, but these are not physical blessings. This is important. These are not physical blessings, as our prosperity church culture of our day falsely teaches. God does not promise us a whole bunch of money, but these are spiritual blessings. Listen to this. What are the spiritual blessings of persecution? Well, let me just share a few of them with you. Persecution strengthens the church. It emboldens the church. We saw it in our study in the book of Acts, how persecution kept causing the church to expand and grow faster. We're still seeing it in the book of Acts. As persecution amplified in intensity, God's people amplified their efforts. Isn't that powerful? As they tried to stamp out the church, the sparks and the embers went everywhere, and it caused more fire of the church. Think about this. Persecution purges the church. Now, you might want to know what the purge is. Well, that's sweeping the church out. That's what that purge means. It means a sweeping out of the church. Purging removes those who aren't serious about the Lord and His work. The harder it gets, the less we see the unfaithful. Am I right? The less we see unfaithful people, the more costly persecution becomes, or costly being a Christian becomes. Persecution purifies the church. Now, think about this. The people that remain in persecution are actually being purified. They're being made better. They're being made stronger. It refines the church. Persecution removes from us everything except what we truly need, and that's Jesus, right? Once we get Jesus out, once we get Jesus as the only thing, there's no other competitors. Isn't that powerful? Think about it this way. And then there's a reason God only wants the serious. This is where it gets really interesting. Persecution is a platform for the gospel proclamation. Think about that. Persecution is a platform for gospel proclamation. You might be saying, well, how in the world does that happen? Most people try to avoid suffering as if it's God's kryptonite, and that believing God is undermined by the suffering of His people. God is not actually undermined. God is platformed when we suffer. Do you realize that? Let me put it to you. Persecution, put it this way. Persecution provides the perfect opportunity for the love of Christ to be displayed. Think about that for a second. Perfect love display must be given to the most undeserving people, right? For perfect love to be displayed. If you give it to the people that deserve it, it's not really well displayed, is it? People don't even notice. But if we go into the area of persecution, And we love instead of hate the person persecuting us. Perfect love is displayed. Let me share this. When we turn the other cheek, we proclaim that God's love is better than retaliation. When we pray for those who persecute us, we proclaim the gospel is available to everyone. Even they can be saved. Even the ones doing the persecuting can be saved. When we bless instead of curse, we proclaim that we serve a God who would rather bless His creation than destroy it. Think about that. We serve a God that would rather bless than destroy. And so He sends Jesus. He could have sent destruction when He sent Jesus. But instead, He sends Jesus to help the world be saved. We deserve destruction way, way back. We don't just deserve it now. We've always deserved it. But instead, He sends Jesus as a display of His love. And He wants us to do the same. When we forgive, we proclaim God's amazing grace. See, like Paul before Caesar, persecution often gives us a spotlight that we'd never have with people we have no connection to otherwise. Now think about that for a second. When we suffer persecution, it often puts us before people we would never see and never speak to. And we can proclaim the truth of God's word to them. I'm trying to pay attention to the time because I know the temperature is rising. And so, I don't know if you guys are having this problem. I think we're gonna have to get rid of the gnats for next week, but they're bothering me. I'm not waving at you. I'm waving at them. Listen, I know that the study just got really heavy, so I like to throw in a little softening spot right there. But listen, persecution pushes the church to the forefront of culture when she's too weak or too imperfect to make it there on her own. Think about that. Persecution, as it's purifying the church, it's pushing it out in front of people who would have otherwise never seen it. Sometimes we're too weak to get there. We don't have the connections to get there. We don't have any way or means to get there. And persecution forces us into places that our persecutors would never want us to have a platform in the first place. But they give it to us through persecution. And so we should be understanding that. Here's what it boils down to. God's purpose for allowing persecution is the perfecting of His people for the proclamation of His power. Amen? And so God promises to use our sufferings for His glory. When we keep getting up and remaining faithful, God's power is seen. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, now you're finally amening me because I thought I was going to have to do the first 2 points over again. No laughter. So those of you on the live stream not hearing laughter, it's because there isn't any. They're not getting my jokes today. Okay, so God promises to use our suffering for His glory. Amen? That's what He promises to do. I'm going to use your suffering for my glory. When we keep getting up, like I said, and remaining faithful, God's power is seen. And that leads to one last thought. It's number three. Here we go. Persecution is spreading and heading straight for us. That's what's happening. If you look over in chapter number 4 of 1 Peter, right where we are already, I just want to read a few verses to you really quickly. Listen to this. It says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. And on their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their soul unto him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator." Wow, what a powerful sequence of verses. Let me just share some things about it so we can kind of bring this to a place of application. If we're honest about what we're seeing in our world today, we have to agree that hatred directed towards God's people is growing. It's growing even here in the land of the free and the home of the brave. Persecution is growing. The desire to silence all statements of absolute authority on morality has people hating the church. Peter was inspired to give this warning that persecution is coming in verse number 12. He says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you." Wow, it's never been, this is important, it's never been a matter of if. It's always been a matter of when, isn't it? Hasn't it always been that? It's never been a matter of if. It's always been a matter of when it comes. That's what he says right there in the Word. The fires of persecution we see globally are spreading quickly towards us with little or no resistance. In fact, I'd like to say they're getting more help than they're getting resistance. It's no longer a question of can we avoid it. And notice a few reasons. First of all, the Bible never teaches us to try to avoid persecution. And it tells us to avoid sin, but it never says avoid persecution. Did you notice that? I think everybody else is trying to hide from pain, but he doesn't tell us to hide from persecution. Now think about this. This is something that may shock you. The theme of this year's International Conference on Missions that's held here in the U.S. every year stated this as their theme: we're no longer the home team. Did you understand that? Christianity in America is no longer the home team. We've been kicked out of that role, and Satan and his devices are now the home team in America. The church has long enjoyed privileged status in America, and as our privilege erodes away, it is vitally important that we don't react with protests and angry outbursts as our enemy does, but with love and grace. I got to tell you, persecution against the church is coming. There's no avoiding it. The scripture says it will, whether it's here in our lifetimes or it's here later, or if it's here by January, who knows? We just know this, that it says it is coming, and we need to live prepared for it. Our violence in response to persecution only causes more violence. If you notice that in our recent months, all that violence has done is just breed more violence. It hasn't changed anything in our country. Oh, it's gotten a lot more different types of publications and protests, but it hasn't necessarily changed anything. Violence never changes violence. But this should not come as a surprise, because we're not of this world, and Jesus told us to expect that there's going to be a violent response from them, and a loving response is supposed to be returned from us. In fact, John 18:35, Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight. And if I should not be delivered to the Jews, but now is my kingdom not from hence." He says, listen, if it was all about establishing it here and maintaining it here, that if God's kingdom had to happen here, then we'd all be armed with physical weapons to fight against a physical enemy. But he says our enemy is not against flesh and blood. It's against principalities, against powers. This is not the eternal kingdom. The eternal kingdom is somewhere else. It's not here. Yeah. That's why he says we're not of this world. He means you're not of this planet and this planet system. We're fighting against it. We're winning as many as we can. But those that do not want the gospel preached are going to fight against it. And so, listen to this. And because of this, persecution will define us. You might be saying, well, persecution doesn't define us. Actually, Jesus says it does. Persecution does define us. As followers of Christ, we rejoice because our lives reflect Jesus enough to share in the same unjust sufferings he experienced. Think about this. Jesus died on the cross. He says, hey, they're going to persecute me. They'll persecute you. If you're really with me, then you're going to be with me all the way. And one of those things is they put Jesus to death. They beat Jesus nearly to death. Think about that. They rejected Jesus at every turn. They tried to find ways to kill him and to overthrow him and to undercut him every chance they could. And he says that if they do that to me, they're going to do it to you. We have enjoyed a season of rest in the church in this country. But it's going. It's going away. I couldn't imagine it when I was a youth pastor where it would come from. Way back when I began working in youth ministry, it seemed like everything was kind of framed by some sort of a residual effect of Christianity. But today, everything is framed by getting Christianity out of the public square and silenced as often as possible. You can ride in an airline, you can go into a busy shopping center, but you can't meet in the sanctuary. That's got to be troublesome to the rest of you, that there's a pointed situation here that it may not be understood by them as directed to the church. Remember that, I need you to understand that. Our persecutors don't always believe that they're stamping out Christianity because Christianity is evil. They're doing what they think is best for their world. Think about that. There's a blindness out there. And we need to remember that when we're engaging them, that we're not dealing with found people. We're dealing with lost people. We're not dealing with sighted people. We're dealing with blind people. And we need to treat them as such. And so, listen, we can rejoice in the face of our persecution as opposed to retaliation or complaining or demanding our rights. And this will set us apart as unique, especially in a day when violence is the preferred tools of those who want something. Right? It's going to stick out a little bit that we're not fighting for those things. We need to remember we're a people operating under spiritual power. Amen? We're operating under spiritual power. It takes real power to bless someone who wishes to harm you. It takes even more power to reach out to them with the gospel. Amen? Doesn't it take a lot of power to bless someone that's cursing you and to reach out with the gospel, someone who'd rather see you dead? I mean, think about that. It takes a lot. The Holy Spirit helps give us resolve and power so the glory of God is reflected in our lives in all circumstances. Amen? Amen. And we need to have that be what happens. Let Christ flow out of us. But we also know that persecution is warning us. It's warning us. Judgment is coming. Those last three verses, 17 through 19 in our passage, we discussed this earlier. God uses persecution to purge and purify his people, but it also is the vehicle that's taking us towards judgment. Christ's return is our motivation. Think about it. It's our motivation because we have to answer to our Lord for the things that we've done in the body and this earth and how awesome it is to be in right relationship with him. But it's also a reminder to us that they only have so much time. And we need to redouble our efforts and then redouble our efforts. No matter what they say against us, we still need to get the gospel out. Because if we don't get the gospel out, they will perish. They'll be lost. And so, one more thought. Suffering will not last forever. Think about that. Even the Apostle Paul said, hey, if you kill me, I go be with the Lord. And so, persecution sometimes is instantaneously over. Because they take it to the highest degree, and then suddenly we're in the presence of the Lord and persecution is over. But even if we live out our entire life under the heavy burden of persecution, it's only for this lifetime. And in eternity, it's bringing out a far weightier importance and glory. Amen? Amen? We got that to look forward to. So we battle on because the lost world, they think they have all to look forward to, but they have nothing. And it's our responsibility to give to them anything that we can in the way of the gospel, no matter what they return to us. Even if the world turns a deaf ear to the terrible suffering of Christians, we must not. We must allow their cries to remind us that a day of reckoning is imminent. The gospel must go out. Let's be motivated to share the good news with all who would hear us between now and that day. And when we do, fires of persecution may be transformed into fires of revival. Wouldn't that be awesome? That our persecution somehow stokes a revival, even if we're not around to see it. Amen? And so let me just do this. Revelation 2:10 says, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee the crown of life. That's what Jesus told the church in that particular verse. He said, hey, listen, know this, that if you're faithful unto death, I've got you covered. You're getting the crown of life. And so persecution is not permanent state, but a state of preparation. Let's be prepared in such a way that we may share Christ's victory. Amen. We want to share in the victory. And so we should expect persecution. God promises it will serve a purpose, and our world is growing more hostile to Christ every day. That's what's happening in our world. And so what can we do to prepare for it? Well, let me just give you a few things as we close. We can prepare for the day, but it will take a little bit more of our time and our attention than most people give now. I just want to say that right now. We're gonna need to put a little bit more of our lives into Him. How we respond to this message on persecution, or how should we respond to this message on persecution? Well, are you shocked, scared, or not really that concerned? I'm just trying to feel you out here. How we respond to this message today reveals if we will be purged or purified. I just want that to be understood. There's some of those things. Are you going to be purged or purified? Will you make your stand or choose to be silent? Will you slowly move away from faithfulness to God, or will you increase your connection and participation as it becomes less comfortable in our world? Right? I mean, we have to ask ourselves these things. Preparation for persecution isn't complicated. It's simply living for Jesus as if He'll return today. It's seeing every opportunity before us and seizing it. That's how we prepare for persecution. And so we need to get ourselves ready for the Lord's return. It's as easy as living as if only Jesus matters. You understand that? We got to go from everything in this world matters and Jesus matters when He's convenient, flipping that over, that Jesus matters, and if other things fit, they fit only when it's convenient and not interfering with what's taking place. I think too many believers today are living as if we have plenty of tomorrows, but we don't. And we need to live as if we don't have plenty of tomorrows. We know that the lost don't have plenty of tomorrows. And so live as if God is all you say He is. Live like you really believe God hates sin, won't put up with idols, yet loves us. Amen? We got to live that way. So what will you do now that you know brothers and sisters in Christ are suffering? Back to our starting verse, Hebrews 13:3. Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. And so let's pray for them and support them. And to those listening who aren't sure where you stand with God this morning, this invitation is for you. So every head bowed and every eye closed. And while we're doing this, if you're sitting in the sun, you need to move. Feel free to move out of the sun. But listen, just as you're doing so, just bow your heads and close your eyes. I just want you to know this. To those listening on the live stream and those here present, God loves you and desires to see you in right relationship with Him. John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. He wants you to have eternal life. He wants you to be in right relationship with Him. And all it's going to take is a recognition that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God wants us to know the reason why there's a separation is not His fault. He created a perfect world. We chose our own ways over His. That's called sin. And so in the process of that choice, all became sinners. He says, everyone is in need of salvation. And the reason why we need salvation is because that sin is worthy of death. That's the wage. That's what it earns. That's what it deserves. But God's gift is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. To anyone who will call on the name of the Lord, they will be saved. And so while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, I just want to offer this opportunity for you right now to call out to the name of the Lord. And you can do it just by calling out to Him a few simple things. God, I realize today that You're out there and You're real, and I can sense that You're asking me to connect with You. I recognize I'm a sinner. and you sent your son Jesus to pay for that sin. I believe, and I ask you to forgive me and save me. It's just that simple. God wants you to be in right relationship with Him. And if you'll call out to Him in some form of understanding of those things that I've said, and ask Him to save you, He will. Father, we come before You thanking You for the opportunity we've had this morning to spend time in Your Word and to remember those that are persecuted around the world. There are many believers today that will die simply because they believe that Jesus is the only way of salvation, as He is. Unfortunately, there are those out there that do not agree. And because they do not agree, instead of simply doing their own thing, they believe they must kill or silence those who believe anything different than they do. I pray, Lord, for those believers today that are suffering. Not that their suffering would cease. That's not their request. Their request is that people would be reached by their suffering. And so we ask You to give them opportunity today, that their suffering would not be in vain, that people would be saved. Lord, I pray that You would watch over us as persecution is coming. You said it would. That we would not only be prepared to survive it, but we'd be prepared to thrive, to be the one that ignites more passionately under persecution, that stands more boldly. Lord, our world is in desperate need, and we need Your help. And the very first thing we can do is acknowledge that it's happening and that it will one day happen here too. So we pray for Your help. We pray for Your encouragement. We pray for those that were listening on live stream, anyone on this property that has put their trust and faith in You today. Lord, I pray that they would reach out to us and let us know what's happening in their heart, because we can't see it. And so I pray, Lord, that You would give them the desire to make it known that they are a genuine believer in You. Lord, I pray all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to thank you for being here. Here's the challenge. It's just simply this. Let's get serious about Jesus in preparation for persecution that will come. It's coming. And then let's remember those who are persecuted. If you're here in person this morning, there's a table over there. There's some magazines, some DVDs, some prayer cards, even some bracelets. You know, everybody does the remembrance bracelets. There's a bracelet over there. There's rubber band ones. And it says, imprisoned with them. It's just a reminder. And if you want to take one per family, I think we have enough for one per family. If there's still some left at the end, please take them. We don't need to save them till next year. We want to get them out. So if there's plenty left as people are leaving, feel free to take one. Even if you're not going to put it on your wrist, you're going to put it somewhere where you'll remember. Remember, take the prayer cards. Take all the stuff. I want the table empty. Leave the map. That's mine. But everything else, I want gone off the table so that it's out and about. Even if you're going to give it to somebody else, please feel free to do so. And don't forget, we have a couple of things coming up. Next Sunday is Friends and Neighbors Sunday. We're going to move to 10:15. Now, you see how it is right now. We have more canopies coming. We're asking you to bring something to fan yourself. We're hoping the weather will go down a little bit. I noticed that people are in the sun. Pick your seats carefully so that you can move around. We're going to continue to adjust and figure out where the shade is, how we can make it better. And bring a bottle of water with you, if you would, so you can keep hydrated. And make sure you don't sit in the sun when it gets to you. If there's a seat to move to, move to it. You don't have to worry about any distraction. There's plenty of that already. I got gnats buzzing around my face. I'm already distracted. And so don't worry about that. And so we want to have everybody here. Donuts and coffee begin at 9:45. If you want to come and help us distribute that, it has to be with gloved hands, and everything has to be distributed. Nobody can pick up their own and stuff like that. So if you want to help us with that, please let us know you're willing to help. And then just be here around 9:30 to help with the food service. We always need help setting up. It takes four guys about 48 minutes to set up. It would take 10 guys about, 15 minutes to set up? And so if you're willing to help set up, we'd love to have that as well. And setting up is going to be an every Sunday thing. It's not going to be just 1 week. We're going to do this for the month of November, and then we'll figure out where we're going from there. So we at least have a couple more weeks like this. And so we're excited about it. Lots of other things coming. Please check the website, check the Facebook feeds. We know that YouTube did not broadcast today, so we're going to upload it in a little bit. And we apologize for that. And so anyway, take some time now and enjoy some sweet fellowship together as we get prepared to put it all away. And thank you for being here.